How do you select a pilot for spaceflight? What sorts of characteristics are you looking for? And how do you test for those? So while this astronaut selection process was going on at Holloman Air Force Base, the people involved began to notice a young officer named Demi McClure, who had volunteered for some of the baseline testing. Because McClure, it seemed, was coming up with better scores on any sort of test that they could devise, claustrophobia tests, centrifuge tests. McClure seemed to be able to handle all this stuff better than any of the prospective Mannheim pilots. And they decided this guy may be the ultimate astronaut candidate. And so Demi McClure was named pilot for Mannheim 3.
Mannheim 3 was to be a shakedown flight for the coming space age. The most complicated, overloaded Mannheim mission of all would launch from Holloman Air Force Base. The problems began even before Captain McClure left the ground.
By the time Mannheim 3 was really ready to lift off, they were down to their last balloon and the weather window was closing fast. So that morning, Demi McClure was sealed into the capsule and preparations were going pretty well until a little minor glitch inside the capsule. McClure was turning to look at a gauge to give a reading to his ground crew, and his shoulder brushed against the personal parachute. The pins on the parachute popped out, and suddenly McClure had yards and yards of parachute fabric sitting in his lap. McClure thought about it for a minute, but if he told them what had happened, he was pretty sure that the project was probably dead, and probably forever. So he made the decision, having once watched a parachute packed, that he would see if he could repack that parachute himself, in spite of the fact that he was sitting in a space smaller than a phone booth, 3 feet in diameter. He began to try to gather the parachute fabric and pack it up and get it stuffed back in the pack. It took him about 2 hours to do it. But he got the chute stuffed back into the pack, got the pins in, and at about that point realized that he'd inserted the pins backwards, had to take the pins back out and partially repack the parachute and get it back into the pack. And by the time he was done with this whole operation, they were almost ready to launch, and he was drenched in perspiration. The principal method of keeping the Mannheim gondola cool was a dry ice pack that was put on the top of the gondola, but someone apparently forgot the dry ice pack that morning, and the gondola was launched without its dry ice. And there were overheating problems almost immediately. As the crew on the ground began to request temperature data from McClure, they were alarmed when he told them not only his own personal body temperature, but also the temperature inside the gondola. They were much higher than anyone expected. And they continued to monitor this with great concern as McClure rose up through the stratosphere. McClure, like Joe Kittinger and Dave Simons before him, continued to assure his ground crew that he was fine. And by the time he'd reached the top of his flight, his personal body temperature was in the range of 103, 104 degrees. By this point, the panel of experts finally made the decision to order McClure to descend.
We were in a C-47 circling underneath them, and the medical people on board said, unless we get him down in a hurry, he's just not going to survive.
Tells you what kind of a guy McClure was. He didn't want to come down in spite of this incredible temperature he was running.
So we start on down with him, and the balloon manufacturer was right next to me, letting me know just how fast we can descend, because the balloons weren't designed for a fast descent, or any kind of a descent, really. They were designed to go up.
The idea of Mannheim 3 from the beginning had been to leave McClure up there, just like they'd left Simons up there, overnight, and bring him back down the next day. Well, now he was coming down late in the afternoon, and everyone understood that by the time he made it back to the surface of the Earth, it would be dark. And this was fairly scary because they were over some pretty rugged mountains.
You know, if he lands on the edge of a cliff, you know, and tumbles, it's going to be a bad scene.
So as McClure came down into the mountains, an Air Force helicopter was able to get a visual read on him with his beacon, and was able to land fairly nearby and rushed up to the gondola, not sure what they were going to find. There was some chance they realized that they were going to find a dead pilot. But instead of that, they saw the gondola spring open and McClure lift himself out with a big grin on his face. He climbed down from the gondola and refused to even accept any help on his way down to the helicopter, in spite of the fact that his body temperature at that moment was somewhere in the vicinity of 108 degrees. They rushed him back to the base hospital, and McClure continued to downplay his condition. He said, it's just no big deal. This was the kind of guy that was almost the prototype for the astronauts that NASA would be looking for shortly thereafter.